Nearly 2,000 public service jobs are already facing the axe, with more on the way. The cuts come as the government searches high and low for the money needed to fund its tax cuts. The belt tightening coming as the country slides into a recession, and also as the Finance Minister Nicola Willis announces she's jetting off to Washington DC today. Before she heads off to the meeting of the five finance ministers group, she joins us on Breakfast. Good morning, Ms. Willis. Can you tell me, you're off to DC for this meeting. Why are you going when, in your words, New Zealanders are enduring a cost of living crisis and have had to tighten their belts. Now is the time for us to tighten ours.
Because New Zealand, our economy, depends on us being able to trade with large countries around the world. And we rely on the global economy, and we need to keep strong relationships with those countries with whom we trade and who we rely on for our security. So that means keeping those relationships strong, and the opportunity for me to represent our country alongside finance ministers from the US, the UK, Canada and Australia is an important one. We do this because we are making sure that New Zealand has a voice on the world stage, and that's why we're prioritising it.
Are you flying business class?
Yes, I will be.
And how many staff are you going to be taking with you?
Well, I will take one staff member. There will be representatives from the New Zealand Treasury in Washington, and that's because at the same time, the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank are having what they call their spring meeting. So there will be Reserve Bank governors, Federal Exchange governors, economic financial leaders from around the world, as well as finance ministers from around the world in Washington at the same time. So those officials will have an opportunity to meet with their counterparts.
Is this an appropriate spend on money given the picture that you yourself have painted of our economic climate? You've used words like fiscal cliff, financial time bomb, an economic mess. Does this not sound like it's the time to pull back on Ferrari trips and replace them with Zoom Corolla meetings?
Well, I think that I would be doing New Zealand an enormous disservice if I decided to cut off our relationships with major global economies.
No one's asking you to cut it off.
Well, there would be an empty seat at the table. You'd have Janet Yellen from the United States, Treasurer Chalmers from Australia, you'd have the Chancellor of the Exchequer, you'd have the Canadian Finance Minister all sitting at the table discussing the global economy in an empty seat for New Zealand. And I think that would be poor form for us. It would not represent our country well, and it wouldn't allow our interests to be advanced.
Foreign Minister Winston Peters has just been in DC. Space Minister Judith Collins has just been to Chicago. We're expecting the Prime Minister, Christopher Luxon, to head up to Washington himself soon. How many more ministers will we see going to America this year?
Well, we've been very upfront that as a government, we think it's important to put energy into our major relationships around the world. That includes visiting with our counterparts face to face. We do think carefully about the travel that we do to ensure that it is of value. In this case, I'm able to go not only to that five finance ministers meeting, because as I said, there'll be finance ministers from around the world in DC at that time. I'll be able to, in one place, meet finance ministers from a range of other countries too. So we think carefully about these visits. I'm in the middle of putting together a budget, Anna. I wouldn't mind a couple more days at my desk, but I've truly judged that it's in New Zealand's interest that I turn up.
Speaking of budgets, the trip comes as we're getting more detail on the level of public service cuts. Radio New Zealand reporting $6 million worth of redundancies at the Ministry of Business, Innovation and Employment already. And they're reporting that you have not asked for an overall estimated cost of these government cuts. Why not?
Because we've been clear with agencies that our expectation is about the overall savings they will deliver. So what we have said to them is we don't have a headcount target, we don't have a specific set of instructions about how you do this. What we want you to do is reduce your overall budgets so that we're not spending as much on public agencies, because that spending has gone up dramatically in recent years without the good results from it. And
but
so that means that if they're able to achieve
dollars,
these...
Though. It's millions
right,
and millions
of dollars.
But they're
also saving... Yes, but they're saving millions more, Anna. And so what matters, I think, to taxpayers is are they overall going to be getting more value? And they will be.
Do you feel comfortable with a final figure of, say, $375 million?
What I want to see is overall a reduction. We've set out our plans that overall we want to save $1.5 billion, and that's net of any costs required to achieve it. So I'm confident that we're on track to deliver that, and that that will support us to do two really important things, and I think we do need to focus on this. One, it will ensure that we've got the resources needed for frontline public services, more police, more corrections officers, more health workers, more funding for schools. It will also ensure we can put money where it's needed most, and that is in the bank accounts of hardworking New Zealanders who've been going through a cost of living crisis and need some relief.
Speaking of hardworking New Zealanders who might need a bit more money, pet bonds. There's already an allowance under the law to claim for damage. Is this a bit of a, this is a bit performative, isn't it? Adding in a pet bond?
No. Look, this just responds to the reality that anyone who's got a pet and has tried to get a rental property will have encountered, which is that many landlords are reluctant to take on people with pets because their perception is that that will lead to more damage to their property. So this policy allows landlords in that situation to say, look, I want a special bond for the pet so that I know that if there is particular damage done, then I've got some recourse to make sure you pay for it.
Talk me through this then, because this, the government is saying this is supposed to help, quote, victims of domestic abuse move on with their lives. It's not really a help when it costs those people more to get out of a dangerous situation.
Oh, well, look, I've talked with Pet Refuge in Auckland, which is a charity that works with victims of domestic violence. And what they say is that far too often, women in particular, become trapped in a situation with a violent or abusive partner because they are not confident they will find somewhere to move where they can take their best mate, their dog or their cat with them, because there's just so few rental properties that will allow them to move with a pet. So if we make there be more options for where people can move with a pet, that will, I think, give better choices to some people.
Speaking of options, a few viewers have raised it this morning. Does this not lead down the path of a bond for children, perhaps? Would you consider ever instigating that?
No way. Children fear wear and tear. I lived in several rental properties when our kids were young. And look, I'll admit, they did get those fingers on the walls and they did create mess. But look, that is part and parcel of family life. And that's what the fear wear and tear rules already in our law are about. And that's what bonds are about. If those kids do excessive damage, then there's already a way of dealing with that.
Nicola Willis, Finance Minister, thank you so much for your time this morning and all the best on your travels.
Thank you.